by listening to the story, and that is, please make sure you can see me, so you can hear the story. And also, if you have questions, jot them down on the paper instead of interrupting the flow of the story and ask me when I'm finished. And please do not talk while I'm telling the story, so I don't have to stop and ask you to not talk. Okay? All right. Let's go back to 1947, the summer in Roswell, New Mexico. Razzle, who's a rancher there at the time, was out on his ranch with his horses. And he noticed that his sheep weren't going near anything. They weren't going near a large debris field that he found. So he called the sheriff and he said, you know what? He said, I think you need to come out and take a look at this stuff. My sheep won't go near it. I kind of got close enough to take a peek at it. And I don't know what it is. I think it might be pieces of a UFO. So George Wilcox, who was the sheriff in Roswell at the time, said, all right, we'll send somebody out to take a look at it. Well, Roswell, New Mexico, happens to be very close to a base, a military base. So George Wilcox knew some of the basemen, some army men over there, so he called over and he got Major Jesse Marcel. He said to Jesse, look, we have a rancher here that claims that he found something on his ranch he thinks is a UFO, so can you come out and take a look at it and see what it is? It's probably nothing. So he said, sure, I'll go out, I'll take a look. So Jesse calls his friend Sheridan Cavett, and he says, you want to go with me? I'm going to go take a look at this. It's probably nothing, but you can get out for a couple hours. So he says, fine, I'll go with you. So they show up at the ranch. And they start to look at the debris, what they found, what all those pieces were, spread over about 200 yards. And the more Jesse looks at it, the more he realizes he doesn't know what it is. He starts to find pieces that look like wood, but aren't really quite wood, and have these kind of writing on it that he can't describe. He described them as hieroglyphics, but he wasn't sure. And in this picture, he drew a similar picture as to what he saw on those pieces. Those weren't the only things he found. He found these larger sheets that looked sort of like tinfoil, but when he would pick them up, they were really light. And he also noticed when he crushed one with his hand and he opened his hand back up, the piece would flatten back out to the original shape. So he started to have a conversation with Sheridan and he said, I don't know what this stuff is. I think we may have found a UFO. I think these are pieces of real UFO. So Sheridan agreed with him because he said, I've never seen anything like this, and we both work in the military. We don't know what this is. So they agreed to put the pieces that they found into Jesse's trunk. So they said they're going to drive it back to the base and take a look at it further, see what anybody else thought. So Jesse was so excited because now it's pretty late. Jesse's so excited about what he found. He stopped at home on the way home, and he had a 10-year-old son. So he wakes him, and he takes him out, and he says, look at this. We found pieces of the UFO. And he shows his son the metal pieces and the pieces of wood with writing. And his son goes back to bed. Jesse puts the stuff back in his trunk, and he takes it to the base. Well, it's only there for a few hours. And they do a press release because now they really do believe at the base, too, the people who came in contact with it, that is pieces of a UFO. So the press release says, we have in our possession a flying saucer. This thing crashed north of Roswell, and we have shipped it all to General Ramey, the 8th Air Force at Fort Worth. Well, as soon as that press release went out, the newspapers saw it, and they picked it up. And the next morning, all over Roswell, on the front page of their newspapers, you see the headline, RAAF captures flying saucer on ranch in Roswell region. Now, these are real newspapers, not like the National Enquirer, you know, giant baby form. No, these were like the real newspapers. So now all of a sudden, the whole community and the world knows that there was a UFO that was picked up, pieces that were picked up. Well, the items were on their way to Fort Worth. As soon as they got there, General Ramey, who's an Air Force specialist, looks at them and he calls back over at the Air Force base and said, what did you guys do? You just over the newspaper. It's all over the media. The radios are blaring about it. You guys are claiming you found a UFO. Do you know what it was? It was a weather balloon. You guys found a weather balloon. And you got everybody in Roswell thinking we have some UFO. I'm sending it back over to you. You have to fix this. You need to fix your mess up. He said, I'm sending it over. I want press releases done. I want photos done. You got to put this back in the newspaper and make sure everyone knows we found a weather balloon. There is no UFO. Well, it gets back to Jesse, because now Jesse has to show up at the press release with the pictures. And he comes into the room the day of the press release, which is basically the next day. He comes in, he sees the pieces that are on the floor that he needs to pose with. And this is Jesse in a photo with the pieces. As soon as Jesse walks in and he takes a look at them, he realizes these weren't the same pieces that he picked off the ranch. These pieces are definitely a weather balloon, and he knows that, because he's seen them before. These are not the pieces that were found on the ranch. Jesse doesn't say anything. Why? He's in the service. You don't question, you just do. So now he's in the service, he's posing with the pictures. The pictures go back out to the media. He calls Sheridan as soon as he's done with the photos, as soon as they're done with the press release. And he said, Sheridan, you saw the pictures. This isn't what we found. Sheridan says, look, it's out of our hands. It's going to the Pentagon. Just forget about it. We're done. Well, that wasn't the end of it. Brazel, the rancher who originally found whatever that was on his ranch, he came forward a couple days later after being seen around town with the military. And he said, look, we kind of made up the story. We thought, you know, there had been some unidentified flying objects sighted around Roswell right before we found all this stuff on our field. And we figured we could make some cash, we could make some money. So if we could make some money, people seeing the items coming to the ranch where the UFO landed, we could make a nice amount of money. But it really wasn't. We know it was nothing. It wasn't really a weather balloon. Well, 2.5 miles from the original site where Brazel's ranch was, at that time, there were several sightings of unidentified flying. Objects that summer. And all the dots on this map represent sightings that summer. It was late at night, and a local resident named Jim Ragsdale was camping with his girlfriend. It was late. They were around a campfire. They heard a loud sound, a crash, saw a bright light in the distance, and they thought maybe a plane crashed. Something happened. So they went to go look to see if they could help, because they wanted to see if there were any survivors, what happened. Well, when they got close enough to really get a look at what it was, they saw a large UFO on the ground. It was damaged, it was broken, and there were bodies that looked not human laying around the outside of it, with another one that was not human trying to help another one. Well, that totally freaked them out. They were done. They ran. They figured they would go back in the morning when it was light and they could really see what was going on, because now they think they just saw a UFO and aliens. So they were up all night talking. As soon as dawn broke, they went back to the site. They couldn't get anywhere close to what they thought they saw before, because it was completely surrounded by military. And the military said, the men who were there were told them, you can't, there's nothing here. You can't come here. This is classified and you can't come any closer. There was nothing here for you to see. We're just doing some cleanup. So they left. They were threatened and were told to leave. Well, that same night where Jim Ragsdale saw those, whatever he saw, Glenn Dennis, the local mortician, gets a phone call from the base. And they said to him, we need to know if you have hermetically sealed child-sized coffins. We need you to bring them over. Hermetically sealed means they're sealed in such a way that no air gets in or out of the coffin. It's almost like a giant Ziploc. Glenn says, well, what happened? Was there a bus accident? Did children die? I'll come help you. This is what I do. I can help you with whatever you need. And they said, we don't need your help. We just need the coffins. Send the coffins in. So he decided to pack them into the hearse, and he drives them over, the ones he has. And he figures maybe if he shows up, he can help. Well, they wouldn't let him much past the entrance. They took the coffins and they shooed him away. They told him there was nothing for him to see. So on his way home, because now he's upset because he figured he could help and he can't do anything, he stops at one of the local bars that are close to the military base. He stops for a drink to sit and relax and try and mull over what happened. A couple hours later, a friend of his who is a nurse comes in. She's very upset. She's crying. He can't calm her down. He keeps asking her what's wrong, and she says, I can't tell you. I can't tell you anything. I can't tell you. Something could happen. So after a few hours of sitting and trying to calm her down and talk to her, she finally tells him. She said, we had to do autopsies. They brought these things in, these aliens in, and we had to help with autopsies. And they weren't human. They were small, child size. Their bodies were smooth. You couldn't tell if they were boys or girls. They had large hair-shaped heads and large brown eyes. And they had three fingers on each hand. She goes, we had to help autopsy. And we were told if we said anything or told anything, we would get in so much trouble. Things would happen. It would be bad. You can't tell anyone. Well, she was transferred from that base shortly after that and died in a plane crash. Let's fast forward a little bit to 1994. In 1994, there was a big push to find out what happened in Roswell. Everyone wanted to know. They said, why is this classified? Why can't we know what happened? We all believe aliens. There were lots of residents who saw things and heard things, and the military was saying something else. So General Ramey was still alive at the time, and he said, look, in 1947, we were doing top secret classified work. We were working on a project called Project Mogul. Project Mogul, we were sending up weather balloons and various things up into the sky to monitor Russian nuclear sites. We wanted to know what was going on. So this is what we were sending up. And this was classified, no one was supposed to know about it, hence the words top secret. So we had to clean up when these things came down, and we had to keep them secure so people couldn't see them. So we were working on a project called Project Mogul. And these aliens that people say they saw, well, they were really crash test dummies. We were sending up these dummies into the air, and they were under different pressure suits, and they were under different, you know, circumstances, and they would come back down, and we would have to go back out and find them. And bring them in. So now we have crash test dummies and everybody's spotting aliens. But we had to go out and collect them. He said, we were doing top secret work. It was no one's business. We had to keep it classified. Well, Glenn Dennis was still alive at the time too, and he came forward and he said, look, residents were threatened. They were told they cannot talk about this, or else they would end up in the middle of the desert and no one would find them. They were told that it wasn't any of their business. But I couldn't help. What happened with the nurse? No one would allow us to help. How come there was so much secrecy if it was just crash test dummies? And he said, and even Major Jesse Marcel came forward and said, this wasn't the same material I found on Brazel's ranch. And to the day he died, he claimed and still said that same exact statement. This was not the same that I found. So what happened in Roswell, New Mexico?